Namaskar. Theories of leadership is the topic that we are going to deal today. We have already studied trait theories, all the four behavioral theories, and after that we shifted to situational or contingency theories. We have completed Blanchard's model. We have also completed Fiedler's contingency approach. Today we are going to discuss the three theories of situations. The first one, that is leader-member exchange theory. It is typically known as LMX theory. Very simply, we are able to understand it. You all are working in an organization. You might be knowing that there are basically two groups that operate within the institution. First are called as in-group and second are called as out-group. Whenever we say about in-group, that means it is a group of those people who are very, very close, very near and dear to the top authority who is working at that institution. Second are called as out-group people. Out-group people are those persons who are not that much near and dear to the top authority. This theory states that the in-group people usually get more growth opportunities, they get effective responsibilities, they get more power from the top level management because they are in the inner circle of top management. This is the way through which we should study this theory. Let me tell you, according to this theory, leaders often behave differently with different subordinates. Why? Why my behavior is different to Suresh and it is not that much good with Mahesh? It's a fact, because certain differences will be there. They establish close relationships with a small group of subordinates early in their interactions. Today I became professor in this department. There are certain people whom I like a lot. Their frequency and wavelength matches with me. I usually interact more with them. They are more responsible. They get more assignments from me. It is a fact of life. If you are working in an organization, this will happen. The theory states that please don't get confused. Don't feel problematic whenever there is certain issue like that. Reason being, every lock has a key. It's just like lock and key hypothesis. A big key cannot fit in a small lock. That means if the persons desire your services, you will be there. So two groups, in-group and out-group. What LMX theory suggests? In-group means good relations with leaders and high frequency of interactions. That means how often you interact and react with the top management. And second is the out-group, formal relations with leader and less frequency of interaction in comparison to in-group. These are the two groups. The theory suggests that the leaders give promotions to the in-group employees quickly, and also that employee turnover rate in such groups is low. Now let us start with a very important principle of management. Peter Drucker has nicely said that each and every individual working in an organization wants to become near and dear to the boss. When he himself is doing it, he says that I am a responsible person of this organization. But the person next to him is doing like that, he states that he is trying to flatter. So this is the part of life. So don't be in that mode. This is more important what LMX theory has suggested. With this diagram, we can study LMX theory. We can see in this diagram, at the top there is a leader, the personal compatibility of the leader, the subordinate competence and extrovert personality of their subordinates. It appeals the leader a lot. Leader always wants certain person who is willing to provide solutions. Leaders are willing to have solutions. If you go towards your leader and tell him, "Sir, I have brought such solution to you. If you adopt this, you will be out of trouble." He wants such people. He does not require those people who come to him with a list of problems and tells him, "Sir, these are the problems that we are facing in this organization. If you are not a part of solution, you yourself are a problem." That is the modern theorists have told like that through this theory only. So the personal capability, competence and extrovert personality appeals the leader. you can see there are three subordinates who are there in in-group: subordinate A, subordinate B, and subordinate C. All the three are there. The degree of interaction is very high. The trust entrusted in these employees is also very high, and above all, the personal commitment is also high. Therefore, they all are within in-group of the leader. You can see that leader possesses only some formal relations with the next three, that is subordinate D, E, and F. Only formal relationships, that is, whenever some task is there, these people meet him. Sometimes you will have to take some more responsibility if you want to move within the group. Therefore, it is suggested try to move in inner group rather than the outer group. That's what that leader member exchange theory suggests. Now we are moving to an important theory, that is path goal theory. This theory has been propounded by Robert House. This is the most recent one. Here, the leader provides the necessary support and guidance to his followers and help them achieve organizational goals. This is the first postulate. That is, leader is providing all the support, all the guidance to his followers so that they can achieve their targets. The second postulate is, leader defines the individual or group goals and helps them to achieve them. Once again, I try to tell you that what should be your goal, what should be your team's goal, and I try to help you to achieve those goals. As per the theory, leaders are accepted by the subordinates when there are certain conditions. The first condition, when they find that the satisfaction of their needs depend upon their effective performance. I am working in this organization. I start feeling that if I perform nicely, then only I will get some satisfaction, then only the leader is going to accept me. If I do not perform, he will not accept me. The second is, they are provided with guidance, support, and rewards needed for effective performance. Guidance should be there. Support should be there. And I must get a reward if I perform in an effective way. These two are there if I want to accept my leader. Leaders are acceptable if these two points are there. Robert House has suggested four different types of leadership in this model. He stated that these are the four different types. The first one, directive leadership. Directive leadership here means the person acts as an autocrat. Supportive leadership. I try to tell the people that this is my support. Whatever support you want from me, I can provide it to you, but you will have to do it at your own. Third is participative leadership. I am not a leader. I am just a part of team. We are working in a team. You may tell me whatever you want. I can do the best along with you. There is no formal relationship. And last is achievement-oriented leadership. Leadership is only possible when you are trying to carry out some achievement. You all might be knowing, we have studied Blanchard's model. That also stated the same thing. We also studied Scandinavian studies. In that case also, the development-centric approach was so important. Similar thing is over here also. With the help of diagram, let us study the path goal theory. You can see at your screen, at first level, we have bifurcated the four different leadership styles. Just now we have studied directive, achievement-oriented, participative, and supportive. With the help of this leader behavior, the outcomes are satisfaction and performance. If leaders are like this, or any of the one style is practiced by a leader, we will move to outcome, that is satisfaction and performance. But this is affected by two most important factors. Number first are environmental contingency factors, that is environmental forces that are beyond our control. That is task structure. We have already completed it in Fiedler's contingency model, that is procedurization of the job, whether the job is procedured or not. The second, formal authority system. How much authority has been given from the top management to me to complete the job? And third is the work group. What is my work group? who are functioning, what are their skills and what are their abilities. Secondly, subordinates contingency factors are there. Now these three have to be taken into account. The first is locus of control. Locus of control means the degree to which I believe that I am master of my own fate. The degree to which I believe that I am master of my own fate, that means I have framed my destiny. Locus of control can be bifurcated into two, internals and externals. The word internal means I am the framer of my destiny. I have framed my future with my efforts and with my zeal. Whereas it comes to external, I always blame the external circumstances, external places, external environment behind my failure. And I say, if this would have been done, I could have done this. This is a failure's statement. So what is your locus of control that creates an impact on your satisfaction and performance? The second is experience. It is very clear through name only how much experienced you are to complete certain assignment. And the last is perceived ability. Let me tell you the difference between ability and perceived ability. Ability means the person is having certain features within himself to complete some assignment. But the perceived ability means, what do I perceive about myself? I am able to drive a car, but internally I perceive, oh my God, will I be able to drive or not? I know how to drive it. I have undertaken a course to drive a car. But even though the perceived ability is, will I be able to do or not? Therefore, perceived ability also plays a vital role. Therefore, friends, leader behavior, subordinates contingency behavior, environmental contingency behavior creates an impact on outcome, that is satisfaction and performance. This is all about the path goal theory. Now, we will shift our focus to next situational theory, that is leadership participation model. This was given by Victor Vroom and Yetten. This is the most modern theory developed after 1964. This is a leadership theory that provides a set of rules to determine the form and amount of participative decision making in different situations. This theory only deals with two different things. First, let us understand that. The first is the degree of decision making that is entrusted within my staff. That is the first postulate of this theory. That is, how much freedom and autonomy I have given to my staff while decision making, whether I decide or you decide. This is what is the first postulate. And the second postulate is the problem attributes. What are the problems you are going to face while deciding? There are certain issues that should be taken into account. So decision quality and employee acceptance, these are the two aspects that we are going to discuss right now. These are the contingency variables in the revised leadership participation model given by Yetten and Vroom. Now, as I told you earlier, this theory deals with the first one, that is decision making autonomy. Whether I have given that much autonomy to you or not, before giving that autonomy, I must try to understand these 8-10 points. The first one, importance of the decision. How important is the decision for me and for the institution? The second, importance of obtaining follower commitment to the decision. Whether the followers are committed that they are going to decide it, they will follow it or not. If they decide something, what is their commitment level? This is step number two. Number third, whether the leader has sufficient information to make a good decision. Without information, can I decide something? I want to purchase a car. I only know about Maruti cars. I do not know about any other car manufacturer. Will I be able to decide in a better way? No, because I don't have the information. How well structured the problem is. The problem structuring is also so important. Problem structuring means, what is the actual problem? Let us differentiate between the two. The first is problem and second is the symptom. Fever is a symptom. And real problem is the bacteria that has caused the fever. If I am suffering from fever, you can tell me, the body is very warm. It's just like 102 temperature is there. You must sit in a bathtub and that should be icy cold. Is it a solution? I will remain there forever. Reason being, I have only treated the symptom. Symptom is my body is excessively warm. But the real problem is is there, that is within, that is the bacteria that has caused the problem. So whether you are evaluating the symptom or you are evaluating the real problem, that is what is desirable over here. Then comes whether an autocratic decision would receive follower commitment. Sometimes you need to take autocratic decisions. This is a fact of life. Sometimes, because in Indian scenario, we require somewhat autocratic persons. We can see in families, people are somewhat autocratic. Otherwise, the family will not be able to run in a better way. That's it. Whether organization is successful along with that autocratic decision, that needs to be followed. Next point is whether followers buy into the organizational goals. The word buy into means there is certain organizational goals that they have to handle. Buy into means what they feel internally, whether they feel that this is my target or they feel, no, it is not my job. Whether there is likely to be conflict among followers over solution alternatives. In a family, I want to purchase a car. One person says A car is good and second says, no, no, B is very good. There is a conflict, neck to neck conflict. What will happen then? If I decide something, is it going to create some conflict? That has to be evaluated previously. Whether the followers have the necessary information to make the good decision, as we have discussed earlier. Time constraints on the leader, that may also limit the follower involvement. This is very important. I have to decide some problem today only. I cannot call a meeting of more than 100 people working with me. Therefore, the autocratic decision will be there. I cannot go for participative decision because the time is very less to decide the things. Then comes whether costs to bring geographically dispersed members together is justified. There is a meeting of the board. People are located throughout the country. Whether they will be able to come within that time frame, within that limit. If yes, then go for that. Otherwise, do not give autonomy to the people. Importance to the leader of minimizing the time it takes to make the decision. Once again, importance of leader emerges because minimum time should be taken for decision. Last but not the least, importance of using participation as a tool for developing follower decision skills. Sometimes to develop the decision skills of the followers, we usually incorporate this method that what you would have done. We come across with one technique called as in basket. That is an effective training technique usually used in which lot many papers having different priorities, they are intermixed and being given to the manager, the trainee manager. He is supposed to prioritize those tasks that if I would have been the manager, I would have done it in such and such way. This is in basket, whether we are doing it or not. This is what the theory suggests. These are the leadership styles that have been conveyed by this theory, that is by Victor Room and Yetton. Very important to understand, they have bifurcated the decision-making style into five, and these are the five styles. Number first, A first, that is autocratic first. Autocratic first means I will decide, I will not ask to anybody because I know better than you. That's it. Autocratic second, in this case, the decision making will be done by me, but I will try to sell the decision. Selling decision means I will ask a few people who are within my group and I will say everybody agreed on this, therefore I have given this solution. The third is C1, that is consultative one. I consult with my subordinates, I consult with lot many people, but ultimately I make the decision making, but I consult with you also. Consultation second, I consult with you. If there are 20 or 25 points, I will agree with you on 20 points, but there will be some points that will be in my control only. I will decide on certain framework. This is what is C second. And last is group second. The group second decision making means I will decide as per the group states. That is what is the group decision making. Let us move further to the next theory. This can be treated as the important model, that is Tannenbaum and Schmidt's leadership continuum. Leadership continuum is very useful while solving the cases and case studies. This variable consists of three different parts, that is leader's characteristics, subordinate's characteristics and situational characteristics. These are the variables that influence the decision making continuum. What is that continuum? You can see this slide that is there on your screen. This is a diagram of Tenenbaum and Schmidt's leadership continuum. The first one, you may see in the blue zone, top level, use of authority by manager. Extreme left, you can see that manager is using his authority fully. It is a complete blue part at the left side. You can see use of authority by manager is excessive. Here we have written at the left side, bottom side, you can see manager makes the decision and announces it. That means autocratic style. Somewhat authority of manager is decreased. That is, use of authority by manager decreases. The blue zone is known as boss-centric leadership. You can see case number 2 at your screen. At this case, the manager sells the decision. That means talks to some people and states, yes, this is a decision for you. Once again, manager uses the authority. You can see the yellowish or gray area, use of area of freedom for subordinates. You can see when the manager is using the authority, at that place, subordinate has no authority. Subordinate has no freedom to ask for the decision-making process. You can see step number 3. Step 3 states that manager presents the ideas and invites the questions from the staff, that whether you have any questions, I have decided this and this. Number 4 is the middle path that we need to practice in Indian scenario, 50% boss-centric and 50% subordinate-centric. What this states, manager presents the tentative decision subject to change and he states that I have decided this. If you want to change it, I can change it also, but please provide your logic behind this. The 5th one, manager presents the problem, gets the suggestion from the employees and then makes the decision. In this case, the area of freedom for subordinate increases, whereas use of authority by manager continuously decreases. Therefore, it is known as continuum. Next case is manager defines the limits, his limits, and asks the group to make a decision. In this case, manager has given complete autonomy to the group to decide what they are willing to decide. Once again, the freedom area increases of the subordinates. Last is called as consultative, that is, manager permits the subordinates to function within the limits defined by superiors. He provides them the limit that within these limits or within this framework, please decide it and then do the needful. This continuum is very useful because there are certain instances where we need to provide autonomy to the staff, autonomy to the subordinates, wherever at sometimes we have to practice the authority from within, that is, we are the persons who are going to do the needful. Now comes the last portion of this talk, that is Rensis-Likert's 1-4 system of management. Very important to study, that is Rensis-Likert. Likert has given 4 different leadership styles. We have already discussed previously, therefore we will have a ready reckoner on that. The first is called as exploitative authoritarian or exploitative autocratic. The word exploitative authoritarian means he is an authoritarian, work-centered, only concerned about the job. My job, I will do it. Uses only one-way communication. I will tell you and you are supposed to do it. Used by theory X managers, he starts feeling that people are least interested in work, therefore they must be thrashed. No confidence or trust in subordinates. I do not have any confidence within my subordinates. Motivated by physical security, economic needs and desires for status. That is, only lower level needs are taken into account. Lower level needs means physiological and security safety needs are there in account. Decisions, only I will make it. Decisions made at the top and above all, issues the orders. There is no consultation. That is called as exploitative autocratic. The second is benevolent autocratic. The word benevolent autocratic means paternalistic in nature, less like a parent or guardian. Work centered with protective, employee centered concern. I am centered with my employees, protective. Secondly, he is having lot of confidence and trust in subordinates. I trust my subordinates. I am motivated by economic needs and moderately by desire for status. Economic needs moderate, but desire for other needs is very high. Decisions made at all levels, but always checked by the upper level. And orders are issued, but with comment opportunities. I will issue orders, but I will also ask for your comments. The last two Likert's dimensions. The first one is democratic and last is participative. We have already completed democratic style of leadership. We have already studied Carlos Ghosn and his leadership model. That was about Nissan. Complete confidence within the staff, within subordinates, two-way communication at all levels. Interaction with individuals and group are very high. Tries to interact with them in a frequent way. Decision making is widely done throughout the organization. I allow you to for decision making. Except in emergencies, the goals are usually established through group participation. Last is the participative. If somebody asks you about Indian scenario, go for democratic and not participative. This is suitable in Japanese management. Both work and people centered. That is just like 9-9 of managerial grid. Substantial but not complete confidence and trust in subordinates. Complete confidence is there, but even though substantial amount of confidence is there. Quite a bit of interaction aimed at achieving objectives. I interact with you freely. Broad policy decisions at the top, but specific decisions are there at the lower level. I allow you to for decision making. Management by objectives is the key philosophy. And last but not the least, orders issued after discussion with the subordinates. This is about Rensis Likert's 1-4 system of management. Let us summarize this session. We have studied the leadership theories, situational leadership theories. Then we studied Tenenbaum and Schmidt's continuum of leadership. Last but not the least, we have studied Rensis Likert's 1-4 system of management. Thank you very much.